Hello everyone, we are on time, so I guess we are on time for lunch as well. I'll try to wrap it up so that you know we are not delayed for that. And I am Rahul. I'm the co-founder at MHK.io. It's a relatively new product. I'm sure not a lot of you would have heard about it. But then what we basically do is real-time image optimization and transformation. And today I'm going to talk about something which, as you know, a lot of people have come up to us and asked that, you know, how do we optimize images based on the user's network, right? Let's say if the user is on 3G or if he's on 2G, how do we change the image that we are sending to them? And consider a typical case where, you know, an e-commerce website loads hundreds of images on their website. They would want to do some kind of optimization for the users who are on a slower network. So that is what we're going to discuss, that how do you optimize images on the basis of what network the user is on. And yes, I am from ImageKit and I would be using ImageKit because, you know, this is a sponsored talk, you would have read in your schedule. But then what we discuss, you can implement that on your own as well. You can use any in-house solution that you might have for images. You can use any other third party that you have for images. And not just images, you can in fact apply what we discuss to other more critical parts of the application, which is the JavaScript and the CSS. You can optimize those as well on the basis of the network, right? So let's get started. This is a rather interesting stat, and I guess most of you, you know, who have worked on front end would be aware about this, that all the new users that are coming on the internet are coming through mobile, right? And globally, that's 55% of all users that are coming from mobile. In India, that's a slightly higher percentage, that's 78%, mainly because of cheaper handsets, cheaper data plans coming in with Jio and Airtel, right? And why am I talking about mobile, right, when I'm talking about service workers? Because network speed is actually a problem on mobile devices and not, you know, you guys work in your offices and you have a very stable Wi-Fi or a LAN connection. You do not have network problems there. The network problem is on your mobile devices. For example, if you step outside your building, you move into the lift lobby, or let's say you moved into basement parking, your network speeds would drop, right? So our ideal target audience for this is people who are using mobile, and that's a big chunk for all websites, right? And we often believe that, you know, with Jio and Airtel and everyone coming in, our users, you know, they have a great 4G speed or a great 4G network. But the fact is not, right? We did this study with one of the companies that we worked with, 91mobiles.com. What we did was that Chrome exposes the downlink speed, the estimated downlink speed that the user is observing at that time, and we tried to measure that. We did that for a lot of users, over 1 million users, and this is what we see, that almost 45% of the users have a speed lower than 2 Mbps, 2 megabits per second. And in fact, almost 25% of users have a speed less than of 1 megabit per second. So we assume that our users have a really fast network, but then the reality is that they do not, right? And contrary to this, in the last 6 years, our page sizes have gone up by 3 times. And the reason is that, you know, we started pushing a lot more JavaScript code with the client side rendering happening. We start pushing in a lot to the client. Videos have gone up in the last year, right? So our page sizes have increased. Our assumption that the network has improved stays, but then the reality is that the networks have not improved as much. And the result is that our users end up with a frustrated experience. They might not even come back to the website, right? I'll go back to the previous slide. I just wanted to focus on the green bar that is there at the bottom. That basically corresponds to images. And I would like you to notice that images still correspond to about 50% of the page weight, right? Videos are coming up, but then images are still the major component in the page, right? So this makes it very clear, right? That up until now, we have been able to modify our website and our content on the basis of, let's say, the user's DPR, or let's say the user's device width. We have made responsive websites, but then not a lot of us have, you know, worked on optimizing the website on the basis of the network speed. And that must change, right? We need to stop building for ourselves. We need to stop building for people who are there on a Wi-Fi connection and can load our website really fast. We need to start thinking of users who are not on a very good stable connection, and we need to start building for them, right? And our target in this talk is we are going to be focusing on images. Reason being that like we observed that they still form more than 50% of the page weight. Plus, the other reason being, images are the lowest hanging fruit, to be honest, right? They might not have as much impact on the overall page load time as, you know, optimizing JS or CSS would have, But then that's, they are the easiest ones to optimize, and they are the easiest ones to start off with. And but then you can apply this concept to any other content on your page as well, right? So now we have two requirements. One is that we need to determine what network the user is on and detect when that network changes. And the second requirement is that when the network changes, we need to change the image size that we are sending to them, right? So we'll look at the first part, right? How do we detect network changes? So Chrome and Chrome Mobile, that is what I recall from what I last read, have implemented this network information API. What this does is it observes all the downloads that are happening in the browser, and it tries to estimate what kind of network the user is on, right? And it exposes a read-only value, which can be read from navigator.connection.effective-type. It basically classifies the user into four buckets: 4G, 3G, 2G, or slow 2G. So when I say 4G, it's basically speeds upwards of 3 Mbps, right? That's the average. It includes Wi-Fi as well. So even though the classification is 4G and 3G, 4G would include really good speeds, including Wi-Fi as well, right? So we do know what network the user is on, what kind of speeds is he getting, right? And 4G obviously is faster than 3G, 3G is faster than 2G, and 2G is faster than slow 2G. So the logic dictates that, right, on 4G, which is the fastest network of all, we need to serve the largest image size. And on slow 2G, which is the slowest of them all, we will serve the smallest image size, right? That's what we want to do. Now, how do we change image size, right? We're not talking about changing the image dimensions. We're not saying that we will resize the image and send a smaller image to a slow 2G user. What we want to do is to, you know, compress it further, right? Compress the exact same image further. And for those of you who would have worked on images on the front end, you would know that there is a factor called image quality that is associated with an image. So very simply put, image quality is a scale of 100, 100 being the best quality, 1 being the lowest quality, 100 being the, you know, the sharpest and the best image that you can get. So I've taken this image as an example, right? Let's say I have the image quality set at 90, which is a standard for a lot of websites. They set their image quality at 90. The size is 47 KB, right? Let's assume that we will use this for the 4G network. Next, let's say for 3G network, we use quality 70, which is giving us a 40% reduction in size. Now, assume that you have a website which loads 1 MB of images. If you are able to save 400 KB out of it, you have actually saved a lot for the user who is on 3G. Similarly, for 2G, we will use a smaller quality level, 55. For slow 2G, we will use 40. And for slow 2G, we are actually reducing the size of images by almost 72%, right? That's a huge reduction for the user, right? Lot lesser data to download. So how do you change quality? This is where ImageKit comes in, right? We provide a lot of transformations that you can do in real time on an image. So for example, let's say I have this image URL, image31.jpg. And let's say I want to get a quality 90 image. All that I'm doing here is I'm appending a query parameter, tr equal to q hyphen 90. It gets me a quality 90 image. If I change that to 60, it will give me a quality 60 image. If I change that to 10, it will give me a q10 image. And I'm not sure if you can see it on the screen or not, but then the Q10 images is actually really low in quality. If you especially notice the clouds above the house, you would find that those are really pixelated, and that is the reason why the size is small, right? So apart from quality, ImageKit does a lot of other transformations, but for now, I will stick to quality, right? That is what we are trying to optimize. So we have figured out two parts. We know what network the user is on. We have figured out a way how to change the quality in real time. You can use anything apart from ImageKit if you can do that, right? I'm just using ImageKit as an example. Now, how do we handle all of this in our code, right? The idea is that we do not want to be changing our code, right? We cannot have our server sending different URLs for different network speeds. We do not want those kinds of changes, right? So this is where the service worker comes in. Service worker is, I guess, a lot of you would have worked on service workers or would have worked with service workers, right? Service worker sits as an intermediate proxy between the user's browser, the cache storage in the browser, and the network, right? And what the service worker allows us to do is it allows us to intercept every request and then decide where do we get the response from. Do we get it from the storage? Do we get it from the network? Do we modify the URL? And that modify the URL part is what we are looking at, right? So what we will do is, let's say I have in my HTML, let's say I am using image1.jpg. If I detect 4G, in my service worker, I will change the URL to use quality 90. If I find 3G, I'll change it to use quality 70. On 2G, we will use 55. On slow 2G, 40. Right? This is what we will use the service worker for, that we will intercept the request and we will change the URL from where we are getting the response. So let's look at some code. My image tag remains exactly the same. I'm not changing the image tag. My quality parameter does not come in the image tag, right? Our image tag remains the same. Next part is, obviously, we install a service worker. I won't go into the depths of it. It's a pretty standard thing. You just need to call service worker.register, the file name, and it gets registered. Now, this is the main function, right? Service worker allows us to hook onto an event called the fetch event. This fetch event is basically fired for every request that is originating from your browser. What we do in the first two lines is that it's a very basic check. We check if it's a JPEG image or a PNG or a JPEG or a WebP, right? If it is, we continue further. We check the connection type. For that connection type, we determine what quality do we need to use. And in line number 11, in line number 13, in fact, we create the new URL. The new URL basically would be, we have appended the quality parameter, let's say, to that URL. And in line 14 to 17, instead of responding with the same URL, we respond with the modified URL. So for example, if the browser sent a request for image 1.jpg and we modified it to, let's say, to use Q70, instead of, so we respond with Q70. We do not respond with the original URL, right? So let's look at an example on how does this work. So this is a basic, something which we have created similar to an e-commerce website. I've already loaded it. But then this has been loaded without the service worker coming into picture. What I've done is I have throttled the network to fast 3G. This is something that you can do in Chrome. And I will just reload the page once, and I hope that the demo works. It does. So what I have done is I have also overlaid the quality number at which the images are being fetched on. Right? So if you see, all images have been fetched on quality 70. Right? All of them have this number 70 overlaid in the top left corner. And if you see the network tab, this is the original request, right? This is the request that the browser fired. I was resizing it to 300 by 450. The service worker intercepts it. It issues a new request, which has Q70 as one of the parameters because the service worker detected that the user is actually on a 3G network, right? So this is what the service worker was able to accomplish, right? So this is very good to begin with, right? So we were able to detect the network and we were able to modify the image. We were able to send a lighter image to the user. But then there is a problem with this, right? And the problem is that the browser does not know that you have modified the URL in the service worker, right? For the browser, it's a black box. If the browser requested for image 1.jpg and you responded with, let's say, quality 40 in the image, the browser does not know. And the browser would cache that low quality response forever or for as long as the cache control allows it to do it, right? We do not want this to happen. Since we are modifying the cache on the basis of network, we do not want the browser to behave as a black box and cache everything that we are giving to it, right? So one thing that we need to do is that we will skip the browser cache completely, right? Instead, what we will do is we will use the cache storage API, which is there in all modern browsers, I guess, in most of them. And we will use it to create caches for different network types. For example, there would be a different cache for 4G, there would be a different cache for 3G, 2G, and slow 2G. And what we will do is we will implement a waterfall kind of a lookup, wherein we always look for the best resource. We know that 4G has the best images. It has images on quality 90. So we would always prefer looking for an image in the 4G image cache. Then we will go to 3G, then we will go to 2G and slow 2G, right? This is how we will structure our cache lookups. This is something that you cannot attain in a browser. That is why we need to skip the browser cache completely. So let's look at the code. If you remember from the previous code example, we were responding with the transformed URL. So instead of that, instead of responding with the transformed URL, we have a new function, which is a step down cache lookup. We will do a cache lookup, and if that cache lookup fails, then we will go to the network, right? This is the cache lookup code. I'll simplify this for you, and I have shared the code on GitHub as well. I'll share the link on where you can read the code. I'll just simplify it for you. Line number 10, 9 and 10 is basically just looking for an object in a cache, let's say in the 4G cache. If you find it in the 4G cache, well and good, we return it from there. If not, we go to the next cache, which is 3G, right? If we find it there, we will return it from the 3G cache. If let's say we do not find it from 3G cache, and we look up, let's say, in the 2G cache, and let's say the user is on 2G right now, if the object is not there in the 2G cache as well, then we go to the network, which is line number 16 and 17. We go to the network. If we have a successful response, we add it to the corresponding network cache, which is being done in line number 18, right? So now we have four different caches. We are adding objects to different caches on the basis of network, right? And we are also picking up the best object that we have available at that time. If we have 4G available, we will use 4G object. So let's see how does this actually work out in a demo. Right, so let me just check if I have cleared all caches. I have. I'll start with a slow 3G, right? So this should get me a quality 50 image ideally. Because it's slow 2G, everything's slow. So if you can see the first image which loaded, it's quality 50. I'll update this to fast 3G and I'll reload the page again. Now, because the network has improved, the browser automatically fetched the better variant of the image. It fetched the quality 70 image. Let's say I remove the throttling completely and I reload the page again. Don't tell me it didn't work. Or maybe I have it. Okay, so basically, it takes time for the network connection type to update. So like I mentioned earlier, the network information API, it looks at the download times that the user has been observing. And because I was observing 3G-like download times, it kept me in that 3G bracket for slightly longer. Now that I have moved to 4G, now we get the 90 quality image. Now let's do the reverse. Let's say the network downgrades again. Let's say the user falls back to slow 3G. What would happen, right? We still have the best image in cache and it should ideally just pick that up. It picks up quality 90 image. And if I look at the cache storage, so we have four different cache storages here. Is this visible to everyone at the back? The cache storages? So we have a 4G network cache. It has all the images cached in 4G. We have a 2G cache. We have a slow 2G. Slow 2G, we never access slow 2G, so the cache is empty. We have a cache in IKit in the 3G cache as well. But then 4G is the preferred one, so our images would always be picked up from this, right? So basically, we have implemented a way where as soon as the user's network speed upgrades, the images would upgrade as well. But then let's say if the user's speed goes down, we would look for the best image that we can serve to them and, you know, not downgrade his experience. Now this presents another problem, which is cache management. Earlier the browser was managing the cache for us. Now we are adding objects to the cache. So we also need to ensure that we are clearing the objects from the cache. For this, I have used Google Workbox. You can figure out any other way to do it. What Google Workbox allows is that you can set up rules on every cache, either on the basis of the number of objects that are there in the cache or on the time. That, for example, let's say objects in the 4G cache would remain there for, let's say, 30 days, and I can have a maximum of 1,000 objects in that cache, right? I can set up this rule and I can create what is called an expiration manager, right? So this is what we do to manage our cache. We instantiate an expiration manager. The last part of the code, this is how an expiration manager is defined using Workbox. We specify the max age in seconds. We specify the maximum cache entries that can be there. And in addition to adding the object to the cache, we also update the timestamp when the object was added in the cache. That's being done on line number 6, right? So that, you know, the expiration manager can see how long this object has been in cache. And from time to time, we keep expiring the entries. You can do a very simple set interval kind of a thing. Every 60 seconds, you just clear out all the objects that should not be there, right? So that's a very simple way of managing what stays in the cache, right? So to summarize, one thing is very clear. It has been a long time that, you know, we have been optimizing for different devices, different screen sizes. It's time that we start optimizing for different network speeds as well, because to be honest, network speeds are not that great in India, and we must stop considering that, you know, we are accessing our websites from our offices or from our Wi-Fi's for us, everything works blazing fast, right? But then that's not the case for our users. So we need to start thinking about them. We need to start optimizing on the network speed. And we talked about images, but then you can get the gist, right? You can extend the same concept to JS and CSS. You can basically tell your server that, okay, the user is on a 3G network. Send me a lighter version of the website, right? So this can be extended to beyond images as well, right? We needed two parts of the problem. One is to detect the network changes and to maintain different caches for every network. For this, we have the network information API, the service workers, and the cache storage. The other part on how do we modify images in real time, that is what we do at ImageKit. Apart from quality, we have real-time resizing, cropping, transformation, etc., face detection, overlays. It comes integrated with the CDN, so the performance stays right up there. And you can integrate it with your infrastructure as well, right? We can talk about ImageKit later, but then as I said, you can do this even without ImageKit. You can do this with your own in-house image management solution if you can modify quality in real time, or you can use it with any other third-party image product. The demo page which I showed, it's there on this link, service work swopt1, and the code is there on GitHub in our ImageKit's GitHub. It's a very basic code. I haven't had time to add the README file. I'll do it as soon after the talk. And you can contact me either via email or follow me on Twitter if you have any questions. Okay. That's it. Thank you.
So my question is in general, also in context to ImageKit as a service. Mm-hmm. So say I'm on a slow network and I have images which have been loaded in poor quality, right? Mm. But as a developer, I want my user, so my images to be upgraded. So what I'm talking about is progressive enhancement.
Right.
Like, so is ImageKit giving me something, or in general, there's a solution for this?
So what we discussed was a very general solution, right? If I see that the network has upgraded, that let's say the earlier the user was on a 2G network and you loaded a low quality image, but then the network upgraded to 4G, the service worker automatically fires a new URL, a new request, right? So the images automatically get updated. Right. So that depends on your application logic, right? What you want to configure. I configured it in a way where it upgrades instantly. Let's say you do not want that to happen. Let's say you will wait for 5 minutes before the user is on a better network to make a new request, you can implement that in the service workers, right? It's a very generic thing. It's not related to ImageKit, like I said. It's something that you can change in your service worker itself. That do you want to instantly upgrade to a better image, or do you want to wait for some time, or on some other logic, do you want to upgrade to a better image, right? It's something that you can do in the service worker itself.
Hi, Rahul.
Where?
Here, right here. Can you see me here?
Okay, yeah.
Hi, Rahul. My name is Shashank. So your talk was quite informative. So I am working on a couple of products in which I have to support users on IE 6, 7, and 8. So Internet Explorer 6, 7, and 8.
Good luck with that, sir.
Yeah.
That's all I can say. I mean, in the best case scenario, see, if we go back to the code, the image tag basically doesn't change. And if, let's say, the browser does not support service workers, even then the same experience gets delivered to your users. So in any case, the experience is not getting hampered. The only thing is that if the browser does support service worker, then we do something additional. Otherwise, the experience on IE, etc. would remain the same. The image tag would load as it is, right?
Is there any alternatives? Because I've seen couple of GitHub projects where there are couple of alternatives, but the options are a lot.
I cannot hear actually.
How about now? Is it clear?
Not yet. Yeah.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. So I was just trying to fix this, and on GitHub there are a lot of basically repositories which have this solution. But the solution, there are a lot of products out there. So I'm finding it difficult to choose the right one.
So a lot of products for network-based optimization or image optimization?
For replacement for service workers for IE8 and 7.
You mean something like a polyfill for service
yes,
workers,
yes, that's right.
Right.
So
I haven't explored it, to be honest. I mean, I haven't come across these polyfills, so I cannot comment on it as well. But then if there are, maybe I'll look into it and maybe I'll update my presentation and talk
okay.
as well.
Thank you. Yeah.
Hey, hi.
Yeah.
So Chrome provides this API to detect the network like 2G or 3G. So what about Firefox, Safari, and mobile applications?
So as of now, the network information API is available only in Chrome and Chrome Mobile, which is basically almost 70% of the users accessing normal websites, right? But then I will update my presentation. I recently came across an implementation which is done in service workers. So basically what the network information API does, that it is calculating the effective downlink on the basis of the download speeds that the user is observing. The service worker does the same thing, right? So your support for network information kinds of gets extended to other browsers which support service workers, right? So that's a slightly wider range of browsers than just Chrome and Chrome Mobile. But then beyond that, like I said, it's a progressive enhancement. It's not something that, you know, if the browser does not support, let's say, network information or service workers, the experience still remains the same. But if it does support, we do something better with it.
So this is a basic elementary question. So can the same approach be extended to switch the format of the image? So if I'm using Chrome and my browser supports WebP, so can I intercept a PNG image and instead serve a WebP?
Right. So in ImageKit, in fact, we do that automatically, right? So
okay.
That is why I didn't cover it, because in ImageKit, when we see that a browser or a device supports WebP, we automatically switch it without even changing the URL, right?
Okay.
But then, yes, it can be extended to other browsers if you can detect that the browser supports WebP, you know, through content negotiation as such, you can modify the URL to fetch a WebP image as well. That can
so
be done.
There are no restrictions but around the, like if the result MIME type differs from the requested image format,
no.
So there are no restrictions.
So for example, you would have seen cases wherein the URL ends with .php, but then the response is image/JPEG, the content type is a JPEG image. So that works perfectly fine because the browser is actually looking at the content type header, and in fact, the actual content that is being sent back, and it tries to determine how to display that content on its own. So it doesn't matter what the original URL has in the extension. For WebP, in fact, you don't need to actually go to the service worker. It's a very it's a much simpler way in which you can you know, implement WebP, which I can talk about, you know, after this talk. It's not related to this, but then you do not actually need to go to the extent of using service workers for it.
Thank you.
Yeah. Hi.
Yeah.
I have a question. Can I use this ImageKit.io if my image is not uploaded on the your domain?
Yes.
Image? Can
so
I
you
use?
Yes, you can integrate it with your own storage or your own image server, anything.
Okay.
Right. So we'll get it from there. We'll do everything in real time and send it back.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Hi.
Hi.
I have a question. As you said, that network type is returning 4G or 3G string, right?
So I'm not able to hear it again.
That network type
mm-hmm.
is returning 3G or 4G or
right.
slot 2G, right? Like that. So what happens if 4G is returned, but actual speed is...
Actual downlink speed is lower.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes. So there are two observations which I had when I was actually working on this. Yes, there are cases where the actual downlink speed is low and the browser still reports it at 4G. So in fact, if you look at the code that we have uploaded in GitHub, we take that into account that if the speed is less than 1 megabits per second, we do not use the effective type that is being returned by the browser. We automatically set it to 3G. That is one way of doing it, that you look at the downlink speed instead of the effective type that is being returned by the browser. But then I read it in another place that these downlink speeds and their mapping to the effective type, it varies from browser to browser, and it can change in future releases. As the network speeds improve, the browsers would update their method of tagging as well. So for example, what is being tagged as 3G today, it may not be tagged as 3G, let's say 2 years down the line. So either you can rely on how the browser is tagging it, or in certain exceptional cases like we have done, if the downlink speed is really low, then we do not actually rely on what the browser is using to tag that. So it's something that you would need to take a call on it, right? If you want to go with the downlink speed or if you want to go with what the browser is telling you the effective type is.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
So can you just quickly run us through how ImageKit would integrate with my infrastructure? Because I think in most use cases, I would serve it from my infrastructure, right? Images.
Yeah, you can take it.
Offline? Oh, okay, cool. Yeah. Thanks.
That's it?
Yeah, hi.
Yeah.
So does this ImageKit works only for images, or it works for 3D models as well for network optimization?
It works for more than images as well, but then again, not in the scope of the presentation, so maybe we can catch up outside and, you know, we can talk about it.
Okay. Yeah. So since it improves the network optimizations by compressing the image size, right? What if we pass the data out of the image and show some business data? When you compress the images or models, the data are being lost, right?
Okay, so you're saying when I'm compressing the image, the data is being lost.
Yes.
But then, see, it's a trade-off that you need to decide on the basis of your application. I think showing a slightly lower quality image, let's say, which is 30 to 40% smaller, but then at least showing that image to the user with, let's say, an option for him to be able to fetch the original image, I guess that is still much better than not loading the image at all. Now, imagine an e-commerce website where the image does not load at all, versus you are at least able to show, let's say, a slightly lower quality variant, but then where the user still gets an idea that, okay, this is a black t-shirt that, you know, that I'm looking at. So if the user gets some idea, I guess a fair bit of, you know, reduction in quality, obviously you would lose out on detail, that's a part of it, but then the user still gets a fair idea of what is the object that he's looking at. And I guess that turns out to be favorable for a lot of use cases. But then again, it depends on your application. You may want not to go for it at all, right?
We parse the data of the 3D models as well as the 2D models.
Sorry?
We parse the data based on the image or the 3D files. We parse it and show the business data to the end user. So for us, it will be not relevant to that, right?
I didn't get your question, sorry, to be honest.
Hello?
Yeah.
So for us, we parse the data out of 2D or the 3D models and show the business data to the end users, okay? So for this, if you optimize this and reduce and compress the data and send it to the end user, it won't be that much efficient for the end users.
Maybe, right? I mean, that depends on what application you have, like I said. So this is very effective for a lot of use cases, but then maybe not in your cases, right?
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, hi. So how the lazy loading of images, how is that difference, and or should it be used in combination with image optimization?
So lazy loading of images is basically you're not loading something which is not visible on the screen, but then when that image is visible on the screen, you still load the highest quality variant, right? You do not take into account that the user is on, let's say, a 2G network. You still attempt to fetch a larger version of the image. That is what the difference is versus network-based optimization, that, you know, lazy loading is something different. Lazy loading is, let's say, you will load 10 images and leave the rest of the 90 out. But then network-based optimization is that when you're loading those 10 images, you would take into account that the user is on a 2G network and that you would load a lighter variant for him and not load the, you know, the best quality image. So they're different concepts, actually.
Okay, hi. My question is on the lines on her question. I'm here.
Oh.
Right in front of you.
Yeah.
12 o'clock. Okay. Yeah. So, say for example, I have the image as, you know, lazy loading. I create a hook after, like, you know, 50 or 80% of the scroll, the next 10 images should load. Okay. But if the speed is too low.
Sorry?
If the speed is too low.
Mm-hmm.
Can I have the service worker change the quality and how much time does it take for the browser to understand that the network has changed and they need to, like, you know?
Right. So, okay. So basically, there is no lag in terms of what the browser tells you the network type is, right? So it's instantaneous. It's
because when you were refreshing, something happened and I was like, okay.
Slow because actually the page was still being fetched from the server, right? So the page load is still slow. All the JavaScript data is being loaded, that is also slow. Only the images have changed. So that is why I said that, you know, images is the easiest bit, but then the actual performance gain would come when you implement this thing for your pages and your JS and CSS. That is where the performance bottlenecks usually are, right? So images though is the easiest bit. In terms of if there is a delay when the service worker is modifying the request or not, to be honest, I haven't seen any significant delay. It's probably just a couple of milliseconds extra where the service worker is actually modifying the URL. Mm-hmm. But then I guess it's a very small time, and it doesn't really matter. I mean, the user on a 2G network would probably end up loading an image in 4 or 5 seconds. If we can make him load it in 3 seconds by serving a lighter variant, so that kind of compensates for the extra time that has been spent in the service worker.
Okay. One more question.
Yeah.
Say if you are implementing this, service worker to for image optimization, you've seen how Medium does it, right? I mean, they send a blurry image, which is very low in size,
mm-hmm.
so that the user can get an idea, it's loading. And then, so would you choose that over this?
So are you saying something similar to what we see on, let's say, medium.com
yeah.
loading their images?
Yeah.
See, it's again a call that you can make on the basis of your business. If you want to serve, let's say, a really blurred out image, yes, that would be the smallest image that you can serve to the user. But then that's a call that you need to make whether it suits your business or not. For an e-commerce company, it might not suit the business. For a content company, it may be fine, right? If let's say you are loading the image of an actor, let's say in an article, right? It's fine if that image shows blurred up initially. But then that might not be true for an e-commerce image wherein you are loading, let's say, the image of a t-shirt, right? You would still want to show the actual object in a slightly more detail instead of loading a blurred image over there. That's again depends on your business logic, right? What do you want to achieve?